Monday the 27th of March. One very big chapter of our history in hiding should really be about politics. But as this subject doesn't interest me personally very much, I'd rather let it go. So for once, I'll devote my whole letter to politics today. The people from outside bring with them a lot of news that's not true. However, up till now, our radio hasn't lied to us. Henk, Mip, Korpus, Ellie and Kraler all show ups and downs in their political moods. Henk least of all. Political feeling here in the secret annex is always about the same. During the countless arguments over invasion, air raids, speeches, etc., etc., one's always hearing countless cries of impossible, or for God's sake, if they're going to start now, however long is it going to last? It's going splendidly, first class, good. Optimists and pessimists. And above all, don't let's forget the realists, who give their opinions with untiring energy. And just as with everything else, each one thinking he's right. They never seem to tire of it. Just as if the German Wehrmacht news bulletins and the English BBC were not enough, they've now introduced special air raid announcements. In one word, magnificent. But on the other hand, often disappointing, too. The British are making a non-stop business of their air attacks, with the same zest as the Germans make a business of lying. The radio, therefore, goes on early in the morning and is listened to at all hours of the day, until 9, 10, and often 11 o'clock in the evening. Arbeiter program, Radio Orange, Frank Phillips, or Her Majesty Queen Wilhelmina. They each get their turn and an ever-attentive ear. And if they're not eating or sleeping, then they're sitting round the radio and discussing food, sleep, and politics. Ugh, it gets so boring, and it's quite a job not to become a dull old stick oneself. Politics can't do much more harm to the parents. I must mention one shining exception. A speech by our beloved Winston Churchill is quite perfect. Wednesday the 29th of March. Bolkestein, a minister, was speaking on the Dutch programme from London, and he said that they ought to make a collection of diaries and letters after the war. Of course, they all made a rush for my diary immediately. Just imagine how interesting it would be if I were to publish a romance of the secret annex. The title alone would be enough to make people think it was a detective story. But seriously, it would seem quite funny 10 years after the war if we Jews were to tell how we lived and what we ate and talked about here. Although I tell you a lot, still even so, you only know very little of our lives. How scared the ladies are during the air raids. For instance, on Sunday, when 350 British planes dropped 500,000 kilos of bombs, how the houses trembled like a wisp of grass in the wind. And who knows how many epidemics now rage. You don't know anything about these things, and I would need to keep on writing the whole day if I were to tell you everything in detail. People have to queue for vegetables and all kinds of other things. Doctors are unable to visit the sick, because if they turn their backs on their cars for a moment, they're stolen. Burglaries and thefts abound, so much so that you wonder what's taken hold of the Dutch for them suddenly to have become such thieves. Little children of 8 and 11 years break the windows of people's homes and steal whatever they can lay their hands on. No one dares to leave his house unoccupied for 5 minutes, because if you go, your things go too. Every day there are announcements in the newspapers offering rewards for the return of lost property. Typewriters, Persian rugs, electric clocks, cloth, etc., etc. Electric clocks in the streets are dismantled. Public telephones are pulled to pieces, down to the last thread. Morale amongst the population can't be good. The weekly rations are not enough to last for 2 days, except for the coffee substitute. The invasion is a long time coming. And the men have to go to Germany. The children are ill or undernourished. Everyone is wearing old clothes or old shoes. Hardly any of the shoemakers will accept repairs. Or if they do, you have to wait 4 months, during which time the shoes often disappear. There's one good thing in the midst of it all, which is that as the food gets worse and the measures against the people more severe, so sabotage against the authorities steadily increases. The people in the food offices, the police, officials, They all either work with their fellow citizens and help them, or they tell tales on them and have them sent to prison. Fortunately, only a small percentage of Dutch people are on the wrong side. Tuesday, the 4th of April. For a long time, I haven't had any idea of what I was working for anymore. The end of the war is so terribly far away, so unreal, like a fairy tale. If the war isn't over by September, I shan't go to school anymore, because I don't want to be 2 years behind. So I must work so as not to be a fool, to get on, to become a journalist, because that's what I want. I know that I can write. Well, a couple of my stories are good. My descriptions of the secret annex are humorous. There's a lot in my diary that speaks, but whether I have a real talent remains to be seen. And if I haven't any talent for writing books or newspaper articles, well, then I can always write for myself. I want to get on. I can't imagine that I would have to lead the same sort of life as Mummy and Mrs. Van Daan and all the women who do their work and are then forgotten. I must have something besides a husband and children, something that I can devote myself to. I want to go on living after my death. And therefore I am grateful to God for giving me this gift, this possibility of developing myself and of writing, of expressing all that is in me. So I go on again with fresh courage. I think I shall succeed, because I want to write. Yours, Anne.
Eva Hadden was reading part 6 of The Diary of Anne Frank, abridged for radio by Nigel Lamberthe.